In this video, I'll go through the groundwork you need to understand before properly diagnosing an oxygen sensor trouble code. I'll discuss diagnostic pitfalls that can trap the unwary, and I'll show a real-world diagnosis and repair of a car with a check engine light caused by a failed oxygen sensor heater.
It's a rainy day. Time to fix a P0161.
Your first important challenge is to correctly identify which oxygen sensor the computer is flagging as bad, so you need to know how these are listed. Large engines have two banks of cylinders. For example, in this V8 engine, there's a driver's side bank and a passenger bank. Bank 1 is always going to be the bank with cylinder 1, and cylinder 1 in motor vehicles is always going to be the cylinder farthest from the transmission, in this case closest to the front. In this Chev, bank 1 is this side. In a Ford or a Subaru, it's on the other side. Now, if you're not sure, Google is the fastest way to get an answer. For example, you can Google Subaru cylinder layout, then click images, and then click on a couple of diagrams that are easy to read and compare the results. Some of those diagrams will have a big arrow, and that's the way the car is pointed in the diagram. When using the web like this, always try to find two sources for critical information, because there's always a chance of mistake. Now, in these big engines, you usually have a catalytic converter on each side. Each bank has its own catalytic converter, and you have an upstream sensor and a downstream sensor to the catalytic converter. By convention, the upstream sensor, which is upstream of the catalytic converter, is sensor 1, and the downstream sensor is sensor 2. So here's the vehicle we've got today. Here's the left and the right catalytic converters, and here's bank 1, sensor 1, bank 1, sensor 2, bank 2, sensor 1, and bank 2, sensor 2. In our case, the scan tool is giving us a P0161, telling us that this is the bad one. Do we trust the scan tool? No, you don't. Generic scan tools can have coding problems that misinterpret the data stream. But not only that, sometimes the PCM is fooled into thinking the problem is an oxygen sensor problem, when in fact the problem is actually deeper. And so it's worthwhile investigating. Fortunately, that's fairly easy. We're going to do that now. To understand this next part, have a quick look at the wiring diagram of the two downstream oxygen sensors. Let's zoom in on bank 2, sensor 2. This rectangle is the oxygen sensor, and it has four wires leading into it. Two of the wires, A and C, go directly to engine ground. Now notice the two strange symbols inside the oxygen sensor. First, look at this one. That's the symbol for a battery, and the diagonal arrow through it indicates that the voltage output varies. That's because it is a battery. When these things get really hot, either from the adjacent heat of the catalytic converter or the heater, the catalyst inside triggers a voltage difference across the two wires that the PCM uses to estimate how much oxygen is present. Now look at this other symbol with its own two wires. That's the heater. It turns out that a lot of the extra pollution happens just as the engine starts, so engineers added a heater to get the live sensor data a couple of minutes earlier. The heater is only needed in the first few minutes of warm-up. After that, the catalytic converter generates enough internal heat to allow the heater to turn off. So if you want to prove the computer can send power down those heater wires, you want a cold engine. You want to think of the heater as a light bulb. When it fails, just like a light bulb, it usually burns out, and the resistance across it goes sky high, so no current can flow. If you have limited equipment or time, the most efficient single test you want to do for a heater code is to disconnect the wires and check for resistance across the heater with a multimeter. For this next part, we're going to run the vehicle and use a scan tool to look at live data and see what the PCM is getting from the four sensors. It's important to realize that the data we read on a scan tool is not exactly the raw data from the sensors. Instead, it's the computer's interpretation of what it sees. Even so, this step is worth doing because it helps to verify that the wiring of the sensor is intact, and it helps to confirm that there isn't anything else going on. Okay, now let's look at how these oxygen sensors are working. The upstream oxygen sensors are 1 and 3, and the downstream are 2 and 4. And you can see that things are behaving pretty much normally here. Both the upstream sensors are cycling appropriately. You want to see that up-down swing, and it's up and down between almost up to 1. I think the peak is about 0.9 on both of them. Nice swinging there. And then you want to see the downstreams not moving much at all. The reason being that the cat should be taking care of that, and that they should be fairly steady. We get steady voltage at 0.76 on both the downstream readings. So everything seems to be hunky-dory in terms of oxygen sensor function. I'll try to explain this next part a little better with a voiceover. This page in the scan tool shows how long it takes each of the sensors to warm up. That time can vary between drive cycles, depending on ambient temperature and how hard you push the engine at warm-up. In this table, there's a horizontal row for each sensor. The value column shows how long it took in seconds for each sensor to warm up for the current drive cycle. The max column is a record of the slowest performance over the past several drive cycles. You can see that Bank 2 sensor 2 is clearly the slowest of all of the sensors. Okay, let's think about what might cause that. This pattern might be seen if the heater is burnt up. It could be a problem with the wiring, or even a fuse between the computer and the heater, or the computer driver itself could have failed. With those possibilities in mind, what would you do next?
All right, let me show you what we got here so far. I've hooked up to the power probe to power and ground, and here we are here. By the way, this is the new power probe 4, compliments of our mutual friend Eric O. And under here, let's show you where we are. I've already douched the oxygen sensor with some PB Blaster in anticipation of having to get it off, but we're going to do the testing first. There are four wires. Of course, the wire color coding is not the same as it is in the diagram because we're on the sensor side, but I've punctured the two dark brown wires on the sensor side, and we're going to measure the power on ground there. Now, I've done this on the sensor side of the connector rather than the connector side for two reasons. The first is that if there's a problem in the connector, I'd like to diagnose it at the same time. And secondly, since we're likely to be replacing the sensor anyway, it makes sense to do the punctures on the sensor side so you don't have to fix the defect. So now let's do the testing.
Of course, you want to do this testing with the engine cold, because after the engine warms up, the heater circuit turns itself off. So we're going to fire up the engine. Do this with one hand, and we got 14.25 volts there, so we've got good power coming through to this side, and then let's check for ground on this side, and we've got ground on this side, so we've got power and ground both going to the heater circuit. Now, a lot of guys would stop right here, but let's prove these wires can carry current. And we've got a red light here, so we are carrying enough current to light a test light. There we are. And that looks nice and clean. All right, here's a telling point. I'm checking resistance on the disconnected heater wires, and on the oxygen sensor, I'm getting infinite resistance. And so clearly the heater is burnt out. Spray down that connection. Okay, all kinds of different ways to do this, but I'm gonna use an oxygen sensor socket. And you slide it on the wiring like that. And then I've got a long handled 3/8 drive socket we'll put on here. And let's hope it comes off easy. There, I had to move the camera out of the way a little bit so I can get the different angle. And it's coming. All right, I don't want to use this wrench here, but the connector won't go over it. So now that I've broken it free, I'm sure it'll work. So I'm just going to cut this connector here. And here's an old mechanic's trick to get a little more leverage with this, just a regular wrench over. Just extends the lever arm a little bit. I've gone back and forth with PB Blaster, and it's coming off easier now. There we are. It looks slightly different, even though this is an AC Delco part. There's my part number. And the connectors, they look identical as far as I can tell, even with the same Christmas tree fitting. Let's put it back on. Now, these come with their own anti-seize. You only use the factory anti-seize, you don't use your own. They say that anti-seize for most oxygen sensors is made up of these glass beads. And the lubricant part of it, of course, burns off right away at extreme temperatures, but the glass beads stay in place and make it easier to take the sensor off the next time.
I'm using the open end portion of this wrench to put it on just because it's easier. I don't think I'd ever use the open end part to take it off, but notice this is a 7/8. It almost fits perfectly, so either 22 millimeter or 7/8.
After that, I erased the codes, I ran the vehicle through a drive cycle, and then I returned home and rebooted the scan tool. You can see on this page, a repeat scan shows that this new sensor warms up considerably faster than all of the other sensors now. Okay, so I use some fancy scan tools, mainly for illustration purposes, but the message I want to get across is that you don't need all of that equipment. You could easily do this with a multimeter and a little bit of common sense, and it's a lot more satisfying to come to a definite diagnosis without having to guess. Thanks for watching.